Company of Wilmington, Delaware, makers of better things for better living through chemistry, presents the Cavalcade of America. Tonight's star, Joan Caulfield. Tonight's play, Patriot with the Chestnut Curls.
July 9th, 1776. I shall never forget this day as long as I live.
When, in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another,
the Declaration of Independence was being read for the first time in New York State. I wondered how I, Sally Townsend, was ever so privileged to hear those wonderful words. Afterwards, when the meeting at White Plains had ended, Father and I rode through the green countryside toward Long Island and home.
Well, Sally, how did you feel to witness the birth of a brand new nation, huh? How did it feel, Sally?
Well, they'll have to change all the maps, Father, won't they? I wonder what color New York will be. Oh, certainly not lobster-back pink anymore.
Sally, have you any idea why I brought you with me instead of one of your brothers or sisters?
Well, Audrey's interested in only two things, clothes and prospective husbands, and Phoebe's too young. And Robert, he's a Tory.
Oh, Sally.
Well, he is. He'd much rather be in New York City in that coffee shop of his, and you know it. Him and his Tory friend.
Oh, no.
All right, Father, why did you pick me?
Yeah. Maybe I needed someone to look after the horses.
Oh, Father.
I brought you because you're an impatient, headstrong, hot-headed
Father.
American rebel, like your father.
I soon learned that declaring your independence and actually winning it were two different things. I shall never forget the night the redcoats rode into Oyster Bay. From down the street, we could hear the angry pounding on the doors of our neighbors. My father was in the room he used for his office. I was with my mother and my sisters in the parlor.
There goes some more horses. So he didn't knock at the Jessup door, Mother.
Phoebe, come away from that window.
What's going to happen, Sue?
Oh, stop. Sniffling off, Audrey.
They're at our door. Audrey, take Phoebe upstairs. Be quick.
Open up in the name of His Majesty the King.
I'll go, Mother. Well, what do you want?
Is this the residence of Samuel Townsend of the New York State Provisional Congress?
Yes, it is.
I have a warrant for his arrest.
Hours of nightmare followed. Hours of fear for my father's life. Then, when we had almost given up hope...
Mother! Sally, come to the window! Hurry!
Audrey, what in the world
is... What's happening? Is somebody else getting in the
room? Father getting out of the car.
Oh, he's free! He's come home! Oh, Father!
Samuel, my boy!
Oh, Father, we were so worried.
You're there now. I'm back and everything is going to be all right.
Oh, Father, I was so afraid. I'm so... Oh.
No tears now, Sally. It's all over.
Well, don't I rate a welcome?
Robert, when did you get here?
Just now. I came with Father. You're all so busy looking at him, you wouldn't even have noticed General Washington if he'd come in.
What are you doing here?
Sally, without Robert's help, I might not be here.
We've heard such frightful stories, Samuel. Are you all right?
Oh, yes. I don't think we'll have to worry from now on.
We won't be under suspicion.
No. No, I took an oath of allegiance to the king.
You what? You took an oath of allegiance? After all the things you said,
Sally, please.
I don't believe it.
And furthermore, Mother, I have offered our guest room to the commanding officer of the new regiment coming into Oyster Bay.
Oh, Father, you couldn't have. A British officer living here.
Who is the officer, Father?
Colonel Simcoe of the Queen's Rangers.
The Queen's Rangers?
Yes.
A fighting troop like that on garrison duty?
That is what I have been told. Would you prepare the room, please, Mother?
As you wish, Samuel. Sally, what's the matter?
Sally. Sally. Oh, she's run to the cellar. Samuel, please take a light and fetch her.
Very well. Father, wait. Let me... I'll speak to her. Sally.
Oh, let me be.
Don't you think we'd better have a little talk?
I don't want to talk to a Tory.
You're going to be awfully lonesome. This is a Tory house now.
Well, I'm not. And I can't believe
it. You must believe it.
Oh, I believe it about you, all right.
Good.
Oh, I don't know what's happened to people. A little while ago, so many believed in our cause. How can people change, though, just because we're losing? It's disgusting.
Is it all out of your system now?
No. It never will be.
From this day on, Sally, you must keep your feelings to yourself.
But I will.
Could you, Sally, if it were to help the American cause?
What do you mean?
Somebody's coming. Sally, listen to me carefully. Living in a Tory household, you will be in a position to hear things. Never breathe the word. But if you should ever hear anything that might be of concern to our cause...
Your cause, too?
Yes, Sally, my cause, too. Don't you understand? Now, if you should hear anything, let me know about it.
Oh, all right, Robert. Oh, but what if you're in New York? How will I reach you?
I'll give you one name. He'll know how to reach me if I'm not here. The name is Daniel Young.
But he's a traitor.
No, he's with us. But remember, not a word.
Robert, Sally, come up at once. Colonel Simcoe is here.
We're coming. Come on, Sally. Come on, hurry.
I don't want to meet a lobster back. There you are. Colonel Simcoe, my daughter Sally, and my son Robert.
We're honored, Colonel.
Good evening, sir.
Well, I am the one who is honored. Your name is Sally?
Yes, Colonel.
Yes. I am indeed honored.
Colonel, are you ready to see your room?
Hmm? Oh, yes, yes. Would you excuse me? I must not keep my host waiting.
I hope he didn't hear you say lobster back. Sally, you must learn to control your speech.
I'll never do it again, honestly.
Colonel Simcoe, the Queen's Rangers. Well.
He's terribly handsome, isn't he?
And important. The Colonel and his Rangers are not here for permanent garrison duty, I can tell you that. I'm certain they're being held in reserve for something big.
But what could it be?
That's what you've got to find out.
A dreadful thing happened. I found I was falling in love with Colonel Simcoe. I wasn't sure how he felt until one night, it was St. Valentine's, he asked me to walk in the garden with him.
Do you know why I asked you to come to the garden with me?
Well, you said you wanted to tell me something.
Yes, I did want to tell you something. But I also wanted to give you this.
A Valentine's?
Read it.
Fairest maid, where all are fair, beauty's pride and nature's care. To you, my heart, I must resign. Oh, choose me for your Valentine.
I would have preferred just to write, I love you.
Oh, poem is very nice.
I do love you.
I'm most honored.
Is there anything you can say to me now? A hint, perhaps, a word that might let me know your feelings?
Oh, I can't.
Why, Sally?
Because I... Oh, not now. Please, wait.
Wait. That word symbolizes my whole life these days. I must wait, always wait.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean...
That wasn't directed towards you, my dear. But I'm a soldier. I have fighting troops under my command. And here we sit. And we must continue sitting until one man gives the signal.
The signal?
The Queen's Rangers are not garrison troops, Sally. And I was promised the attack that may end this war. But when? When? Sally.
Robert, what are you doing home?
We've got to speak quickly. I must be back in New York tonight. You found out anything?
No.
But surely something must have been said.
Robert, listen to me. You've got to understand. I shouldn't be doing this. I mean, what I'm doing here is...
Distasteful? I don't like it either, Sally.
I want to help. Really, I do. If I thought I was doing something important, It would be easier, but this tattle-telling...
Someday you may have information we need. Information that could win or lose a battle for us. Do you understand that?
Yes.
Good. Right now, the situation is very bad for our side. But the British haven't followed up their most recent attacks. They seem to be waiting for something. Colonel Simcoe is waiting for something. We believe he is the key. I think you'll know, Sally, when what he's waiting for arrives. Do you understand, Sally? Do you?
Yes, Robert. Sally, would you see who's at the door?
Yes, Mother.
Good afternoon. Is this the Townsend residence?
Yes, it is, sir.
And Colonel Simcoe's lodgings?
Is that Major Andre?
Major Andre.
Come, you've come. You've finally come.
Sally, may I present Major John Andre, Miss Sally Townsend.
How do you do?
Sally, please forgive me. I must talk to the Major. It's most important.
Yes, of course.
Come along, John.
What's the news? The word, man. When do we move?
Sally, who was it?
What, Mother?
Sally, what's the matter? Was it a visitor for the Colonel? He sounded very excited.
Yes, Darren. He's been waiting a long time for the message this visitor brings. And it's come. At last.
Cavalcade of America. Joan Caulfield is starring as Sally Townsend in Patriot with the Chestnut Curl. Sally Townsend, heart and soul with the rebel cause, sets herself the task of spying on the two British officers. Phyllis is in the Townsend home. And finds to her dismay that she's falling in love with one of them, Colonel John Simcoe. Right now, the Townsend family is alone at breakfast.
We thank thee, Lord, for what we are about to receive.
Amen. Now pass the porridge to your father, Phoebe.
Yes, Mother. Father?
Yeah, thank you.
Sally, guess what?
What, Audrey?
I'm going to have a surprise tea party for Major Andre tomorrow. Mother said it was all right.
Well, can I come?
Will you make tea cakes, Sally?
Oh, I'm so tired of your tea parties, Audrey.
Is that all you can ever think about, parties for British officers?
Well, since when did you start objecting to the company of a British officer?
Oh, you don't know. Oh, all right, Audrey. I'll make the cakes for your tea party.
Oh, please don't go out of your way.
Girls.
But, Father, I don't see what's so different about my enjoying the company of Major Andre than Sally's enjoying...
I said I'd make them.
Sally, sweet, I'm Simcoe. Sally, sweet, I'm Simcoe.
Mother, make her stop.
Well, yes. That old Valentine he gave was worn out the way she carries it around in her pocket.
Stop it.
Phoebe, you're not to tease your sister.
Oh, it's perfectly all right, Father. She can mention... Colonel Simcoe. Oh, you
want
to
do
that?
Oh,
Sally. Phoebe, look what you've done. Sally,
don't mind. You come with me, dear. There's something I want to say to you.
Go with your father, dear.
Now, Phoebe, aren't you ashamed of yourself?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Come in here.
Just like that.
Sally.
Yes, Father.
I must ask you a question. Are you in love with Colonel Simcoe?
I don't know.
I have been told that the British have many ways of winning American patriots.
Have they won you, Father?
You weren't speaking of myself.
Ever since the night you came back after the arrest, I felt so alone in this house. I can't say any more. But everything is just dreadful now.
Sally, I think it's very important at this time that you know you are... not alone in this.
What?
You never have been. Robert thought it best I play Tory.
Play Tory?
Even with you. But the others must never know.
You know that Robert is a spy?
Sally, Never use that word.
But you said...
I said the British have been exceedingly successful at winning the support of some patriots, and that's all I said.
Oh, yes, Father.
I have even been told that someone at West Point, under the command of General Benedict Arnold, is negotiating with the British.
At West Point?
That is my understanding.
Oh, no.
Now, if West Point fell into British hands, it would separate the American forces. That would be a fatal blow for our troops.
I remember now. Robert said...
What makes it even worse is that the unknown West Point officer is negotiating with a British officer stationed here in Oyster Bay.
Right here in Oyster... The Queen's Ranger.
Yes. And we've got to find out two things. Who is the British officer? And what man he is contacting at West Point? I see you've stopped crying, my child.
Yes, Father. I've stopped crying. A spy in Oyster Bay. Who is he? How could we stop him? I couldn't get Father's words out of my mind. But what could I do about it? Later that day, I was still trying to figure things out. And as I thought, I worked. I baked seed cakes for the party. I finished one batch and was just about to take the cakes into the dining room when I heard it. It was a door leading from the hall into the dining room. The room opened slowly. I tiptoed to the doorway and looked in. A man I'd never seen before, dressed in rags. He was stooping in front of the corner cupboard. Suddenly he turned, and as I dodged back out of sight, he must have recrossed the room because then I heard the door again. I waited a few moments. I hurried to the cupboard. And there on the first shelf was a letter. It was thick. And it was addressed to Mr. John Anderson. I don't know any Mr. John Anderson. Still, I replaced the letter, closed the cupboard, and started for the kitchen.
Where are you going, Sally?
Oh, Mr. Andre, you startled me.
Yes, I see, I did. I thought perhaps you would join us on the lawn. Unless, of course, you have something better to do.
Oh, no. No. I mean, I'd love to join you. But there's something I must do. Oh, my cake. I rushed back into the kitchen, afraid I'd say more. Perhaps I'd say too much as it was. Then suddenly I knew that letter was meant for a spy, and that spy was someone as it was. Then suddenly I knew that letter was meant for a spy, and that spy was someone in this house. I had to get it somehow and give it to Father. Once again, I went into the dining room. I ran to the cupboard. The letter was gone. There was only one person who could have taken it. Major Andre. I flew up the stairs to my father's office. And that's when I heard the voices. They were coming from John Simcoe's room. I hesitated, then crept closer. I had to know.
It could be a simple operation, actually.
Simple. West Point should fall like a stone. And according to the letter, the time to start is now.
Good. It settles it.
West Point. The letter was connected with West Point. I didn't know which way to turn. My father was nowhere around. And then suddenly I remembered. I wrote a note for Robert, telling him all about the letter to Anderson and repeating everything I had overheard about West Point. Now I had to get it to Daniel Young. I slipped out of the house to the barn and saddled my horse.
Oh, Mr. Young, thank heaven you're here.
Sally.
Robert told me...
You know these gentlemen, don't you? Major Joseph Green and Captain James Fisher of
the British Army.
Oh, why, yes, of course.
How do you do? Now, what can I do for you, Sally? You mentioned Robert.
Oh, yes. Well, you see, I know it sounds silly, but we're having a surprise tea party for Major Andre tomorrow, and I haven't any tea. So I thought if you'd be good enough to deliver this note to Robert in New York, he'd send you some.
But surely you could borrow tea here in Oyster Bay.
Oh, I could, Major Green, but, well, you see, I want Robert to send a special kind, a bohee. It's John Simcoe's favorite.
Oh. Well, I should say that Colonel Simcoe is a very lucky man, what?
When I finally got out of that house, I was so relieved. Suddenly, I stopped. In my concentration on sending the note to Robert, I had just naturally assumed that John Anderson was Major Andre. But what if it was John Simcoe? I don't remember the rest of my ride home. And it wasn't until I walked into the room I shared with Audrey that I learned the news.
Sally, where have you been? Did you hear? There's no surprise party tomorrow. Isn't it a shame? He's been called away on an urgent mission.
Who?
Major Andre.
Oh. And Colonel Simcoe?
He went too.
Some time later, I learned what had happened. My brother Robert came home.
It was your note to me that did it, Sally. Benedict Arnold had given out word that if any man by the name of John Anderson approached West Point, he was to be sent to Arnold immediately. Only because of your message did we know that John Anderson was a British agent in disguise. Benedict Arnold escaped, but we captured Anderson.
Oh, Robert, was it...
No, Sally, it wasn't Colonel Simcoe. It was Major Andre.
Robert.
Colonel Simcoe is not directly involved, but Major Andre...
Yes?
He was hanged as a spy.
Had I been a soldier in the field and killed him with my musket, I might have been able to justify myself. I prayed to God that I would never have to face Major Andre's best friend again. Then one day, 3 weeks later, John Simcoe returned to Oyster Bay.
My regiment's been ordered into the field, and I may not be back for months. But, Sally, you're crying.
Hearing your voice again makes me think back.
Andre?
Yes.
I don't know if you can understand, Sally. When two soldiers are good friends, they're always aware that death may take one or both in the course of war.
But the way it happened...
He was a soldier fighting a war. Whoever was responsible for his death was fighting a war, too.
John, I...
Don't say anything now, Sally. When a unit has won the war, I'll come back. Wait for me, Sally.
When England has won the war, he rode away, and my heart was heavy, for I knew I would never see him ever again.
Thanks to Joan Caulfield and the Cavalcade Players for tonight's story, Patriot with the Chestnut Curls.
Ladies and gentlemen, this week the American Legion is holding its convention in New York City, and I'd like to present Mrs. E.A. Campbell, National President of the American Legion Auxiliary. Mrs. Campbell.
It is indeed a great pleasure to be here tonight and present, in behalf of the American Legion Auxiliary, an award to Cavalcade of America. The award, based upon the results of an all-member poll of the auxiliary and representing the listening preferences of more than a million women and their families, is in cognizance of the program's highest inspirational, educational, and entertainment quality. In winning this award for the third successive year, Cavalcade has achieved an honor accorded to no other program. I therefore take great pleasure in presenting this award.
Thank you, Mrs. Campbell. The DuPont Company deeply appreciates your selecting Cavalcade of America to receive this award. We're most grateful for your recognition of our program, and we'll continue, as always, to dramatize the freedoms and the ideals of our American way of life. Tonight's DuPont Cavalcade was written by Robert Soderbergh and Edith Sommer, and based on material from Sally Townsend, Patriot, by Dolphy H. McGee, published by Dodd Mead & Company, Incorporated. Original music was composed by Arden Cornwell, conducted by Donald Voorhees. The program was directed by John Zoller. With our star, Joan Caulfield, our Cavalcade players were Neva Patterson, Vera Allen, Sandra Spicer, George Petrie, Tom Collins, Cameron Prudhomme, Richard Newton, Carl Weber, Mercer McLeod, and Lester Fletcher. And this is Cy Harris reminding you to be with us next week when the DuPont Cavalcade will present The Melody Man, the story of a 20th century Pied Piper, starring Robert Cummings.
The DuPont Cavalcade of America came to you tonight from the Belasco Theater in New York City and is sponsored by the DuPont Company of Wilmington, Delaware, makers of better things for better living through chemistry.